Well, yeah, you can see me getting older and older and older in the film, right? It was such an uninvasive process making this film. I forgot about it most of the time. I mean, I never expected it to get finished anyway. So when it was a very pleasant surprise. And at first I was dreading seeing the end result when Evan said, you better come over and see this. When Evan Chan, the director, said, come over and see it. I think I have a rough cut for you to see. And I was dreading it, you know. But then I was so pleasantly surprised at what he had done with all this material and put it together in such a creative and interesting and vibrant way. Made me look good. I think Somei Sato is very happy to be part of this film. He's a dear old friend of mine. It's a friendship that goes back to 1984. Yeah, just over 20 years. I had first met him in New York when he was there on an Asian Cultural Council grant. I was introduced to him and he played me some recordings of his music, of his piano piece Litania, and I was just swept away. It was unlike anything I'd ever heard, and I'm only interested in music that sounds like no other, that each piece has to have a distinct, unique voice, and this was just something I felt I had to play. You see, then I recorded this album of Somei Sato's music, which was the first recording of his music in the West. And I introduced him to American and Western audiences. I was very happy to be able to do that because I felt his was a distinct, unique voice that should be heard. And you know, when Litania first came out, it became a cult album. And I'm very happy to say that 20 years later, it's still an album that has a life. It's still bought and people know about this album, and they still say to me, you know, I remember when this album came out. It was so magical, his music on it. So this makes me very happy, and I think Somei's influence and reputation in the West has grown considerably as a result of, you know, my introducing him to the West, and I'm very, very, very happy that I was able to do this, and I hope our collaboration will continue for many more years to come. Now, his music is unmistakably Japanese in its feeling, in its aesthetic. He is so deeply rooted in Japanese culture, whether it is the use of space, the concept of ma, which permeates his music. It's something that is so ingrained in him, this sense of Japaneseness, that even though he's avant-garde, it's a very distinct Japanese expression of avant-garde. Oh, I wish I did show you here. I bought a beautiful toy taiko drum yesterday, which is exactly what I was looking for. And I found a new bicycle bell. A deeper one. I went to Tokyo Hands and found with Yuki yesterday, and we bought all these. Oh, I'm really thrilled with my new treasures. Well, I will be doing another toy album, toy piano and toy instruments album, and this time it'll be in DVD as well as CD. It will be released on Mode Records within the next year. I'm also doing a very interesting collaboration called Mourning, M-O-U-R-N-I-N-G, Mourning, with the Butoh dance duo Eko and Koma. We are presenting this in its world premiere at the Japan Society in October of 2007. Japan Society is having its 100th birthday, and they are also creating a tribute to Kazuo Ono. on his 101st birthday. And Eiko and Koma were students of Kazuo Ono.
では中のメカニズムであるアクションをちょっと。
It's very simple. It's just a little plastic hammer.
ハンマーはプラスチック製です。
That's attached to a piano key.
で、これがキーにつながってて。
And the hammer hits metal rods inside the piano instead of hitting piano strings. It's hitting metal rods.
ピアノだと金属製の弦のようなものが通っております。ストリングがあります。しかしこれの場合はロッドですね。金属製のロッド、普通鉄の棒のような板のようなものなんですけど、それをこのハンマーが叩きます。
I think the toy piano because it has a very limited dynamic range from loud to soft. There's really only about it's very small limit. So you have to work very hard to create the illusion of dynamics.And I think to play Mozart or Beethoven on toy piano is not so crazy as it may seem. Because, you know, many people say that the sound reminds them of the harpsichord a little bit or the forte piano. And I think the sound of the toy piano is actually closer to the forte piano of Beethoven and Mozart's day than the rich modern voice of the 19th century, romantic piano as we know it today, the piano developed really in the 20th century. So I think the toy piano voice is closer to the piano of Beethoven and Mozart's day than the modern piano's voice is close to the. Actually, I wonder why the piano has to be so complicated, because the piano has over 200 moving parts. Because pretty much what I can do on the big piano, I can do on my toy piano.